The original Pickle was lost on a shoal in 1808. But this boat is an exact replica and gives us a perfect insight into how she'd have handled all those years ago. She weighed a mere 127 tons, and with only 10 guns, she didn't pack much of a punch either. But she was handy, a small, agile craft, capable of pulling off manoeuvres that larger ships wouldn't have dared attempt. I'm raring to get her out to sea to find out just how she handles for myself. To discover what this little ship is really capable of, I've brought along a shipmate of mine, Craig Nutter. Craig's a circumnavigator and racing professional who knows more about sailing fast than anyone I know. Today, there's a force 8 to storm 10 predicted. Not the sort of weather you'd normally consider setting out in. But we've got an experienced crew, a proven ship, and these are exactly the sort of conditions that would allow us to see what the Pickle is really made of.
So I've got my little GPS here, and it shows us doing between about 7.5 and 8.25 knots. Yeah. You can really feel the power. There's a bit of a heel on the boat, and we are moving nicely.
That's great. We've just taken a gust of wind over the quarter, which is where any sailing vessel likes it best. And the boat staggered, leaned a bit, came up and took off. And we're on our way. What a great feeling. And you know, this schooner really surprised a lot of the old boys with the square riggers.
As we head out of the straits, the wind begins to pick up, and I'm keen to find out what it is that makes this little ship sail so well.
So, Craig, topsail schooner, what makes her such?
Well, we've got to look around the boat itself. There's the main mast with the mainsail on it, which has a standard 4.5 type gaff mainsail. We have the foresail here, which is on the foremast. And the mainmast itself is on the schooner configuration is normally taller than the foremast.
Yep.
What's interesting on this one, it's got a called a topsail schooner. That's because if we look up, we can see the little square topsail that's set above the foresail on the foremast.
Yep.
And then we come to the jibs up forward. The jibs themselves help balance the power and force of the big sails at the back to actually help her track along.
As we break out into open water, Craig picks up a sign that shows us it won't be too long before we can really put this sail plan through its paces.
I've just been noticed on the water over here, a slightly darker patch of about two minutes away, and I imagine that's going to be quite a big increase in wind.
Yep.
Craig's as good as his word, and soon we've a gale force 8 coming over the port quarter. The perfect opportunity for me to find out just how well the Pickle's hull and sails really work together.
She's actually amazingly light. Beautifully balanced vessel. I'm steering her here comfortably with one hand. And there's many a gaff cutter half this size that you couldn't do that on with this weight of wind. She's balancing beautifully and she's driving along like a sweetheart. Absolutely lovely. I'm just steering her on the edge of the wind here. I've gone a little bit too high. The wind's just getting around the back of my head. So there she goes. You feel her take? Isn't that lovely? That's when the sails fill.
But soon the wind is gusting up even higher.
Well there, Tom, that's the gust we talked about coming in.
Yeah.
These are challenging conditions for any boat. And now the Pickle's crew are fighting just to keep her on track.
Here's the gust. Exactly right behind us now, because we've actually come onto the wind a bit. You can see it's just crabbing slightly and the amount of force the helmsman's having to put in.
Yeah.
Try and keep the boat tracking straight.
Yeah, he's working now, isn't he?
The Pickle is sailing on the edge of her capability, as fast as her length and design will allow. You're much closer to the elements on a small ship. And contemporary accounts speak of the Pickle as a wet, uncomfortable boat. Her fine lines might make her fast, but they also allow a lot of water over the rail.
Sweet! Sweet tack.
And with over 40 men on board, conditions must have been wet and miserable, even down below.
Back then, it was very, very different. The cabin sole that I'm standing on, which is as low as it can be today, where if the boat were leaking, there'd be water sloshing around. I expect it's dry down there now. And a bit of ballast, that's it. But in those days, that's where all the stores were. So that cabin sole was lifted up, right up here. So there were two decks. In there, in that dark, damp glory hole, there were barrels of water, there was all the cheese, all the food, the barrels of salt beef, the stores, the cannonballs, the powder, the lot was all down there, and the guys had to live up here under about 4 foot 6 inches of headroom. But somehow, in this cramped, tight space, they managed to maintain their morale and drive this ship as fast as anybody could drive her and deliver the goods.
And in 1805, as the Pickle headed for home, the mood on board ship must have been sky high. Lieutenant Lapenotiere thinking of his promotion to commander and the huge £500 reward. But only 2 days into what should have been a straightforward run north, they saw a sight that must have changed the mood in a heartbeat. They were being hailed by a larger, more senior vessel, a square-rigged sloop of war, HMS Nautilus, commanded by a higher-ranking officer, Captain Sykes. Nautilus commanded the Pickle to stop.
There, look, the Nautilus, there it is. So this is where he's come across Sykes, right here off Cape St. Vincent.
The encounter is faithfully recorded in the Pickle's logs, and it gives an hour-by-hour account of what was about to turn into an epic race for home.
Normally, Lapenotiere would have had to go on board this senior man's boat.
That's right.
He'd have been summoned, but because he had these important dispatches and Collingwood had said nothing was to divert him, he actually wouldn't move from his own deck, and this superior officer had to come on board and see him.
Sykes was trying to snatch the Pickle's mission for himself. The meeting between the two captains lasted over an hour as the Pickle's crew waited on tenterhooks. Would their captain stand tall, or would he give in to the demands of a determined officer on a bigger and what should have been a faster ship? As Sykes left the Pickle, Lapenotiere gave his order. Crack on sail, boys. But Sykes hadn't given up. He sent a dispatch to Lisbon, relieving himself of his duties, under the pretense of making sure Pickle completed her journey safely.
Thus, as you might say, covering his large transom, his rear end, just in case anybody gave him a hard time. So now he's covered, he can give it his best shot, and he sets off in pursuit of Lapenotiere.
A day later, the crew of the Pickle were horrified to see HMS Nautilus on the horizon once again. This time, though, she wasn't stopping. She pulled level, and then ahead. On paper, it was no contest. But this was one fight Lapenotiere and the Pickle were determined to win.
They would have been trimming everything. They'd have been moving the sheets 6 inches at a time. Very likely, they actually held the sheets for the main sails in hand, rather than making them fast, just so they could get every last tiny little bit out of the vessel, because they knew that that quarter of a knot could give them an hour at 6 knots. And this was a 7 or 8 day run home. That could give them 7 or 8 hours, which would be a whole tide, which would leave the other vessel blown away. Every little bit counted, and they were really going to work at it, night and day.
Both ships were making good headway, but as they headed up to Finisterre, the square-rigged Nautilus pushed ahead, driven by following winds that suited her sail plan perfectly. In the Bay of Biscay, weather conditions worsened. The Pickle's crew were pushing their boat to her limits, and in the rough seas, she started taking on water. Now, Lapenotiere wasn't just racing, he was also fighting to stay alive.
So what's he do?
Well, we already know because his pumps weren't working. He actually was having a bucket chain to bail the water out.
No, frightened man in a bucket, best exactly. bath pump in the world.
But also, he takes an extraordinary act of actually throwing the guns and the gun carriages overboard.
For a Navy ship, throwing your guns over the side was a last desperate measure. Now, the Pickle was helpless as a fighting ship, but as a sailing vessel, she was lighter and faster. But with the Nautilus out of sight, what the Pickle needed now was a lucky break. And as the wind changed direction, she got one.
This schooner is now doing what she does best, actually. She was able to sail on her course with that wind direction. A square rigger wouldn't be able to do that. She would be driven away out into the Atlantic, to the westward, and would thus have to sail further, if indeed she could get there at all.
Finally, the Pickle's great advantage, her more modern rig, was coming into play. Now she picked up her skirts and flew for home.
Yeah, standing here, looking out of that bowsprit, feeling her filled with wind and just lean to it and put her shoulder to the job. You understand now, a brave little boat like this could have beaten Sykes and got home to England with the news. Lafonetti, eh? He knew what he was about.
But just as it seemed Pickle was about to win the day, disaster struck again. Within sight of the south coast of England, the wind suddenly died. The Pickle had been aiming for Plymouth, but now only miles from Falmouth, Lapinottier had a choice. Get off here and face a longer journey by land, or try and coax another 40 miles from the Pickle in uncertain winds. And without knowing where the Nautilus was, he had only his instinct to go on. Lapinottier made his call. Leaving the Pickle behind, he ordered his crew to row him the final miles to shore.
By getting himself ashore, Lapinottier showed himself to be a clever man. He kissed goodbye to the tides, but you know, getting himself up to London was not going to be a walk in the park.
Lapinottier had no way of knowing where Sykes was. All he could do now was make sure he got to London first and delivered the news that king and country were waiting for.
Lapinottier had taken his big gamble going to Falmouth, not Plymouth. Now he needed rapid transport to London. So he went to the local car rental man who didn't have a Mondeo, but he did have a post chaise, the fastest on four wheels. So he hired it and set out for town, post haste. Now it was hell for leather all the way to London. A long, long journey, 270 miles. He changed horses 21 times, and it cost him dear. When he added up his expenses at the end of the trip, he was horrified to learn he'd spent £46 on, half a year's salary for a lieutenant, and there was no way he could be sure of ever getting it back. Falmouth to London is a long haul today in a car. In this, we're moving at boat speeds here. Right now we're going down a steep hill and I could get out and walk faster. It must have caused Lapinottier to eat his liver.
But after 37 hours on the road, Lapinottier had reached London. After a race of over 1,000 miles, he discovered later he'd beaten Sykes by just half an hour. The Pickle had done it, and now it fell to Lapinottier to claim his reward and announce the tidings that the nation had been waiting for. With studied economy, he drew breath and told the First Sea Lord, "Sir, we have gained a great victory, but we have lost Lord Nelson." Today, Trafalgar and Nelson are names known to everyone. But for most, Lapinottier and his little ship, the Pickle, are all but forgotten. To me, the Pickle sums up everything that's best about the sea. A boat packed with new ideas, sailed to perfection by men with timeless qualities. And the news she carried changed British history forever.